Let's just get a little lift in there. Wake you up after that lunch. We don't need a nap. Page 138.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry.
Pay attention to verse 2. Let's go.
All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, parents my soul's best song. Faithful loving service to
Amen, amen. You may be seated. It's a good song to get the blood flowing again. Praise the Lord again. We got a good activity at the end. But for now, we're going to get our minds and our hearts in focus to prepare for the preaching of the Word of God. Again, that's the purpose. We're glad that you're here to have a good time. But we're going to ask. I asked Brother Pastor Gunther if we'd have Victory come up and do a special. And again, as they get ready, you guys can come on up. Just listen, get your heart in tune for the preaching of the Word of God. One second, there you go. Hold it till it's green.
If you're interested in just coming in for a visit, just text that word visit to 810-202-9552 or give us a call. And again, the show's on the weekend. The staff is off. We'll call you again on that. But we look forward to seeing you. Just text the word visit. Call us at 810-202-9552.
We know that, but have you considered the impact of taxes?
Who has held the oceans in his hands? Who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice.
Behold! counsel to the Lord. Who can question any of his words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds? Behold our God, seated on his throne. Come, let us adore.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that. And what a song, what a message. Brother Mark, you can come on up and make your way up. Again, I appreciate Brother Mark Smith, friend of mine for many years, PBI graduate. He's been on the mission field, pastor church, and just got a heart for the God and knows the book, and I know he's going to preach to you. So I hope you're prepared for some preaching. Praise the Lord. Here you go, brother. You're on.
Amen. It's good to be saved.
Amen. Amen.
I appreciate that song. I tell you, come let us adore him. Man, you think about the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that high and lofty one that haveth all eternity. Woo! Think about him sitting on that throne, us bowing down and worshiping him, man, one day without this old flesh. Amen. Man, I'm looking forward to heaven. Amen. Amen. I hope I can be a blessing to you this morning. If you got a Bible, if you'll turn to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 10 this morning. Hebrews chapter number 10, thank Lighthouse Baptist Church, thank Pastor Reese for the invitation to come up here. Hopefully I can be a blessing to somebody. I want to preach on something rather serious this morning. It's been on my heart for a while, but the last several weeks the Lord just put circumstance in my life that just made it very, very clear to me what I was preaching is what He wanted. And so I ask you that you take your undivided attention, pay attention. Not just to me, not just what I say, but what God says in the Word of God this morning. Young people, if I can just have your attention for just a little while. Hebrews chapter number 10, and if you'll stand once you find that, for the honoring, the reading of the Word of God. Hebrews chapter number 10, and we'll begin there in verse number 16. Hebrews 10, and verse number 16, the Bible says this. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I'll put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Amen. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for He is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father God, I come before you. Oh Lord God, I need you this morning. I need you, Father, to help me. Cleanse thou me, Lord, from presumptuous sin and from things in my life that may hinder, Father, the Holy Spirit of God from having free reign in this room. God, I beseech you, Lord, by the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, you're my Heavenly Father, and I beseech you this morning that you would, Lord, move on the hearts and the minds of the hearers this morning. Lord, these young people, Lord, if there's ever been a time for preaching, Lord, it's to this generation, Lord, the last days that we live in, Lord, we need the Word of God. We need preaching of the Word of God. And Lord, you said, Father, Lord, there'll become a time where they not endure sound doctrine. Lord, I pray, Lord, this morning that people, Lord, will pay attention and have utmost attention, Father, to the Word of God. I pray, Lord, you'd help me, Father, to preach what you've laid on my heart. Lord, would you stir, Lord, in some heart and some soul, Lord, if there's one that's lost. Oh, Lord God, would they realize it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. Help me this morning, I ask, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Here in our context, here in Hebrews chapter number 10, the author addressing there, and he opens up talking as we picked up in verse number 16 with the new covenant. He begins to go down in a discourse and talk about the new covenant and how this new covenant versus the old one. And he says there that he will make a new covenant with them, put his law in their hearts, and in their minds will he write them. And he says, in their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Is that not a blessing? We could stop right there and praise the Lord and talk to him about how good he is that my sins will he, and my iniquities will remember no more. Isn't that good to know this morning that if you've been truly saved, truly been born again by God's grace, hammered down, heaven bound, Holy Ghost sealed, that you know what this morning? Your sins are gone. Your iniquities are forgiven. Praise God, your transgressions are under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Boy, he starts talking about the new covenant. He talks about those things that God has done. He goes down through there and he says, now where remission of this is, there remaineth, there is no more offering for sin. I'm thankful there's nothing else I have to do. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, he said, it is finished on the Mount Calvary. There's nothing else I have to do. It's finished. It's a done deal. God, the Lord Jesus Christ, wrought that victory. He's forever perfected them, the Bible says there in our text. You know, forever them that are sanctified. If you're born again, if you're washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're made whole, you're sanctified, you're set apart, you're made complete in the Lord. He goes on, he says there in verse number 19, notice there, having therefore, brethren, because you're forgiven, because you've been washed in the blood, because there remaineth no more sacrifice, there's nothing else you have to do. Having therefore, brethren, he goes on, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. We have that privilege now that you're saved. You can go into the throne room of God and beseech Him and talk with Him. He goes on, he says there, therefore, verse number 22, let us draw near with a true heart. He starts talking about things. Now that you're saved, now that you're born again, now that you're sanctified, now that you can enter into the throne room, let us draw near. He points out a few things. He says about a true heart. Boy, young people, if I would ever say anything to you, man, have a true heart. Be honest. have a true heart. Don't just come to these little meetings you have, and don't just come to church and come to Sunday school and come to youth pastors and just play the man. Come with a true heart, wanting something from God. Now that you're saved, now that you're born again, now that you're sanctified, come with a true heart. He goes on, he says this, in full assurance of faith. And we need young people to have full assurance. I appreciate the young man preached this morning. You could tell him quoting the scriptures and everything else, he had some assurance of what he talked about. We need some young people today that will have assurance of what they talk about. Amen. I to stand up and tell their friends, tell their family, tell their extended family, tell their cousins. Have full assurance of what you're talking about. It goes on, it says, having our hearts sprinkled. Notice this, from an evil conscience. When I read through this, as I've been praying and seeking the Lord, I read through Hebrews chapter number 10, and that verse stood out to me. And that phrase, having being sprinkled from an evil conscience. Well, I'm here to tell you today, this generation is saturated. Our society is saturated with an evil conscience. An evil conscience. Your conscience is the path of which brings conviction and is the moral governor of what is right and wrong. Boy, our society don't have that anymore. They don't have that. The Bible speaks in the scriptures, if you'll study it out, the Bible speaks about having a weak conscience. The Bible starts speaking about having your conscience, seared. The Bible talks about having a defiled conscience. And the Bible starts talking about an evil conscience. If you'll bear with me just for a second, I didn't have time to take these notes, but I took a picture of it. I don't like cell phones in the pulpit, just my personal preference. But nonetheless, I'm going to quote this here in Webster's 1828. He says this about the word evil. The word evil means this, having bad qualities of some moral kind, wicked, corrupt, perverse, wrong, as an evil thought, evil deeds, evil speaking, an evil generation. He says this, as a noun, the word evil is this. Natural evil is anything which produces pain, distress, loss, or calamity. So you put that together, you see that your conscience is the moral governor from right and wrong. And you see evil as something that causes pain, causes distress, causes things going wrong in your life. An evil conscience. You put those things together and you see where we're at today in our society and all the influence and the wickedness is about us. Cell phones and Facebook and the internet at the very your thumb's fingertips and everything else. We are saturated in the midst of a society, a generation with an evil conscience. Look there just at the fruit of an evil conscience in our text quickly. Look there in verse number 23. The Bible talks about in verse 22 about the evil conscience. In verse 22, it says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. You know what an evil conscience will cause you to do? Start wavering in your faith. Amen. No doubt in my mind, some of you young people mean right now. You mean right? I'll use you as an example, David. Is that all right? Because I know you a little bit. You know what? No doubt in my mind, you mean right. You've got a right heart right now. You're in church. You want to be in church. You want to be filled with the Spirit of God. You want to know the Scriptures. But you know what? This evil conscience starts creeping in. Your conscience becomes weak a little bit. It becomes wounded a little bit. And from the fangs, the onslaught of this world, it becomes starting to affect you. And you get wounded. And it gets defiled. And then it becomes evil. And then you know what? Your faith starts wavering. I know Dad said this, and I know Chad said this, and Pastor said this, but, you know, is that really how it is? Is that really what the Bible says? Is that really what we're supposed to do? Before you know it, that evil conscience begins to start wavering your faith. Amen. Your faith will begin to waver. That's a fruit of a evil conscience. We look there in verse number 24. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and unto good works. Notice he keeps saying, let us. You know, an evil conscience will cause you to waver in your faith, but not just that. It'll cause you to no longer provoke unto love and good works. You know what? Right now, some of you mature teenagers in your youth group, you're kind of leaders in the youth group, and you want to help others out. But you know what? Some of you that's got the evil conscience there, you don't provoke one another to love and to good works. You know what we need? We need a youth group that are filled with young ladies and young men that will encourage one another. Hey, let's do right today. Hey, let's serve the Lord today. Hey, let's sing a song today on the bus. Let's do something for Jesus Christ. We need somebody, some young people, they'll stand up in this generation, today, tomorrow, next week. They'll say, you know what? Let's provoke unto love and to good works. Provoking, but that evil conscience gets in there. And that morality starts dropping and everything else begins to unfold. And before you know it, your faith is wavering and you're no longer provoking to love and good. I wonder this morning if there's somebody in the midst of us this morning that used to be a better Christian of the Lord in their youth group. They used to be the one that would provoke and they're kind of slipping a little bit. Goes on, not just the fruit of a wavering faith and not provoking unto love and good works. Look in verse number 25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. I wonder if you're forsaking the fellowship. The youth meetings and youth activities and other things come up, right? I wonder this morning, some of you youth pastors and things this morning, you can look out amongst your youth group and say, you know what? So-and-so is supposed to be here today. Something happened. Amen. Grandma got sick. She stubbed her toe. He had to miss. Different things come up all the time. There's always excuses why to miss church and why to miss the activities God has for you. And you know what? They begin to miss the fellowship. You know what you need? Iron sharpeneth iron. I don't know about you, brother. I don't know you very well. But you know what I need? I need preaching. Amen. You know what? I'm vile. I'm wicked. I need preaching. I need exhortation. I need iron sharpeneth iron. I need somebody to provoke me into love and good works, encourage me, and that's only found. The only thing's going to strengthen my wavering faith, the only thing's going to help me provoke me to love and good works is not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Being around other preachers, being around other singers, being around other Christians, going on the street, passing out tracts, and telling others about the Lord Jesus Christ. But when you have an evil conscience, you see, it begins to get defiled and begins to get muddled up there and your faith begins to waver. Should we really pass out tracts? Should we really knock on doors? And should we really do this and do that? And you begin to waver a little bit and then you begin not to provoke unto love and good works, and you forsake the assembling of yourselves together. I want to preach for a little while on a defiled conscience there. If you will, let's get into the meat of the message. Notice there in verse number 26, it begins to get deeper. The Bible says this, for if we sin willfully. If we sin willfully. You know what I see there in an evil conscience, the fruit of it, in essence, number one, is there's no more fear of sin. When your conscience begins to get wounded and weak and all those things and gets defiled, then there's no more fear of sin anymore. The fear of the Lord is clean, right? Amen. The fear of the Lord is that cleanness. And one, it's the hate, pride, and arrogance in the evil way. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth the way of sinners, nor setteth in the seat of the scornful. The ungodly are not so. You see that ungodly cry, oh, you're saved, you're born again. That's not you, you're not that ungodly. But what you'll do, you'll begin to slip in all that. And those things, what you'll begin to do is there's no more fear of sin. What a tragic thing when you meet someone that has no fear of sin. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogancy. And the evil way in the froward mouth do I hate. Is that you this morning? Do you fear God? Do you fear sin? Does it scare you and shudder you? We got a call. We was coming home from church just 2 weeks ago and my wife's uncle passed away. And it just struck my heart. He was 50 years old. 50 years, that's fairly young, young folks. That's young. And I knew her Uncle Joe, and we had talked before, and her Uncle Joe had been through a life, been through a lot in life. You ever met somebody that, man, they just really had things against them? I mean, really, just every time it seemed like he had tried to do right and get in church and trust God, just things fell apart. Just wasn't his thing. It just didn't work out. And you feel sorry for those people. Man, look, he's got it hard. And he had some children, had a child that had a lot of trouble and things. And man, your heart just goes out to those people. Man, they've just got it rough. Well, old Joe's faith started to waver. And over the long... I'm sorry, I'm thinking in German some. The last time I preached in German, so bear with me a little bit. In the time going, I don't know how you say that in English. Nevertheless, the time going, what was that, Case? Help me. As time went on, there we go. Amen. I'm thinking, laufende Zeit, as time went on. As time went on, Joe began to slip in his faith. He began to miss church a little bit here and there, and things went on, and Joe began to just sip on the bottle just a little bit. A little bit of alcohol, you know, just a little bit, just to kind of numb that mind and sit back in the evening and just drink just a little bit, just to forget everything. Forget the troubles of his children and forget the heartaches and the woes of the job and his marriage and everything going on with his mom and everything going on in his life and the tragedies that's happened. He just wanted to just forget it all just a little bit. Time went on, Joe began to drink a little bit more and a little bit more, and this all happened in just several years' time. Joe came down and had cirrhosis of the liver. Joe died there in West Virginia at Morgantown Hospital of cirrhosis of the liver. Once he realized what was going on, he came in and the doctor said, "You're too far. There's nothing we can do." Now maybe, Joe, if you hadn't drunk for 6 months, we could put you on a list and maybe you could get a transplant, a liver transplant, but it's just too far. You know what happened? Joe didn't fear sin. Right. He didn't fear drinking just a little bit. Amen. He didn't fear it just a little bit and a little bit and a little bit and became a whole lot. Right. And a whole lot. Amen. And before you know it, Joe was drinking. I talked with him just about this time last year, and I talked with him, and he was down and he was depressed and he was crying on the couch. And I told him, I said, "Joe, if I can help you, I said, I want to pray with you. Whatever I can do, I want to be there for you and your mom and the situation, whatever I can do for you, I'll be all right." And he went back in that room, started drinking a little bit. You know what Joe did? He didn't fear sin. I got a cousin, I got a call Tuesday. This past Tuesday, this week, Tuesday, that our cousin Ashley, she's 40 years old, is in the hospital. They're diagnosing her with cirrhosis of the liver. I went to the hospital, I wanted to go pray with her. I don't even know if she's truly saved. And I tried to talk with her over the years, so I said, "I'm going." I told my wife, I said, "I'm going to the hospital." Everything under the sun went wrong where I couldn't get to the hospital, couldn't get there. Got there late that evening. I sat down beside Ashley's bed there, and I told Ashley, I said, "Ashley, how you feeling?" She said, "I'm not doing good." She said, "How are you?" I said, "Well, I've got a lot on my mind." I said, "You know, I'm preparing a message to preach to some young people." And I said, "You know, I think I'm going to preach on the fear of the Lord." She started crying. She said, "I wish I'd feared drinking." She said, "I've been telling everybody, it's everybody else's excuse. My husband left me and my daughter and all my mom and dad." And she said, I've been telling it's everybody else's reason why I'm sick. She said, "It's mine." She said, "I've got to be honest. It's my fault I didn't fear drinking." That wasn't for an illustration. That was out of her own mouth. Amen. She didn't know what was going on. I didn't know she was going to call me, or I didn't know what was going to happen. Ashley didn't fear sin. Bible says in Romans chapter number 7, the Apostle Paul's talking. He said, "Sin that might appear sin become exceeding sinful." Amen. No doubt in my mind, if some of you kids, if y'all went to that funeral and saw that mother weeping and saw her son who just started college, his first year of college, lose their dad, some of you would have feared drinking. No doubt in my mind, if I took some of you with me to the hospital there Tuesday evening, you would have feared drinking. But I wanted it I want to get it across to you. You need to fear sin. You need to fear sin right now where you're at. You shouldn't have to see it. You shouldn't have to go through it. You shouldn't have to have that experience for you to fear sin. Oh, that sin would become exceeding sinful. Some of you kids are messing around and dabbling around. No doubt in my mind, you think mama don't know and pastor don't know and daddy don't know and uncle don't know and nobody knows, but the eyes of the Lord are in every place beholding the evil and the good. The Lord knows. The Lord knows. The fruit of an evil conscience. You begin to have no fear of sin. But number two, notice. In the Bible says here in verse number 28, he that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. You know what I see? There begins to have no fear of the Scriptures. No fear of the Scriptures. Now that's a trembling thing. A preacher can get up here and roar his voice and preach with power, and that shudders you sometimes. But what when you just read your devotion? What when the youth pastor just brings a simple little thing and just reads the verse that nails you to the wall and the Word of God pierces your heart? What do you do with that? What do you do with it? Deuteronomy chapter number 6, I'll just read a few verses here. Deuteronomy 6, verse 1 says, "Now these are the commandments and statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you." God commanded to teach you these laws and statutes and judgments. Why? That you might do them in the land whither ye go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments which I command thee, thou, thy son, and thy son's sons, all the days of thy life, that thy days may be prolonged. Deuteronomy 17, verse 19. Just reading a few scriptures here. Deuteronomy 17, verse number 19. We'll look up verse number 17 in Deuteronomy. "Neither shall he multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away," talking about the laws of a king. "Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold, and it shall be when he setteth upon the throne of his kingdom that he shall write him a copy of this law in the book out of that which is before the priests, the Levites. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all the words of this law and these statutes to do them." You know what? The Lord says over and over and over again, read the book. Read the book. Memorize the Scripture. Teach it your sons. Teach it your sons' sons. Tell everybody, you know, put the Word of God everywhere. Put it at your gate. Put it down while you go down the path. Talk about the Scriptures when you're working and when you're doing this, when you're doing that, that you might fear the Lord. Amen. But there's a generation today, I don't believe they fear God. Right. You see it so evident whenever you stand on the street corner. Thus saith the Lord, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. What then will ye do with Jesus, which is called Christ? Will you accept him or reject him? They quote for profanity and they curse you and they do unseen things and forbidden things. And they mock the Word of God. They mock the Scripture, the Word of God that's able to save their soul. They mock those things, but you know what? You see it in the house of God. You as a preacher, you as a youth leader, it breaks your heart. You as a pastor, you know the situation's going on and you've been in prayer about it and you're not being a pointy, but you've been preaching through the book of Genesis for 30 weeks now and you're going to cover that passage that's going to nail them to the wall. And you're fearful and you're like, Lord, help them to have a right heart. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm not trying to be blatant, but they got this trouble going on and here I am this morning. And you as a youth pastor, you as a pastor, you begin to preach the Word of God and you see no change. You see that family, you see that young person walk back and not affect them. Woe unto you if the Word of God don't affect you. and effectually worketh also in you that believe. Woe unto you who don't fear the Scriptures. Deuteronomy 28, verse 58. Won't take for time's sake, in Deuteronomy 21, we read about the rebellious son who would not listen to his father and would not listen to his mother. And they came to Moses and said, What should we do? This our son is rebellious. They brought him forth and they stoned him with stones. You know why? That all might fear. That all might fear. Deuteronomy 28 and verse number 58. Deuteronomy 28 and verse 58, it says, if thou wilt not observe to do all the words, W-O-R-D-S, of this law that are written in this book, that thou mightest fear the glorious and fearful name, the Lord thy God, then the Lord will make thy plagues wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues, and of a long continuance, and sore sickness, and of long continuance. Moreover, he will bring upon thee all the diseases of Egypt, which thou wast afraid of, and they shall cleave unto thee. What a fearful thing if you don't fear God's word. I'm reminded of a friend of mine. It's been quite some time since we went our separate ways and things. I haven't saw him in a while. His name was Timmy. Timmy loved to run. He was a great track star. He loved to run. He loved to do things. And Timmy ran. And boy, he brought some gold and medals and things like that for his high school. And he did everything. But you know what? Timmy got called to preach. Timmy surrendered to call to preach. And Timmy got called to preach. And he started studying the Bible. Boy, he loved to run. So he tried to memorize Scripture and run and just quote Scripture to himself. And he's doing great. But then some of them track meets kept him out of church. Some things going on, some things in life. He had a decision. Was he going to go run and train, or was he going to spend time at the youth activity? Timmy decided, I'm only young one time. I'm only a teenager once. And Timmy began to run and train, and he began to forsake the Word of God. His youth pastor set him down and talked with him a little bit. And he said, Timmy, you're called to preach. You're one of the leaders here in the youth group. And Timmy, you've been doing so well, but I see you slipping a little bit. And they began to warn him about Amnon had a friend. Right. He began to tell him about his friends and those things that would bring you down, and your friends will bring you down. Amen. The Bible says, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. It will corrupt you. Timmy began to slip a little bit, and before you know it, his conscience was defiled. He had an evil conscience. He began to spend more time, and he began to forsake God altogether, just as the steps as the Bible said this morning. You know what? Timmy wrapped his car around the old light pole one night, 16 years old. He laid in intensive care for several weeks, and the doctors didn't know if he'd make it or not. By Timmy's own testimony, he pulled through by God's grace. Timmy said he laid there on that hospital and felt the hand of God over him and said, Timmy, can you hear me now, Timmy? Can you hear me now, Timmy? Timmy's own testimony, as you see him in church, you won't miss him. Walks to that limp air and an old shriveled up hand. Timmy says, I hear you, God. I want to listen. I want to listen to your words. I want to listen that evil communications will cut good manners. I kept running with the wrong crowd. I kept running with my old buddies, and I didn't listen to the preacher. I didn't listen to my youth pastor. I didn't listen to your words, God. Timmy will drag that leg. He's a good preacher. I love him. He's a good man. Doing something for the Lord now over in Kentucky. But I just wonder if Timmy had just heeded God's word, what did that wreck ever happen in his life? He didn't fear sin. He didn't fear the Scriptures. And lastly, this morning, if you look there in Hebrews 10. Hebrews 10 in our text. No fear of sin, no fear of the Scriptures. And look there in verse number 29. No fear of the Savior. Of how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. Woe be unto you. Our text opened up with God's grace, God's forgiveness, that he'll put your iniquities and your sins and remember them no more. And he'll give you that sanctification. He'll give you that salvation. And the writer opens up with that new covenant and how great that is. But then he closes this passage. He says, man, when you've got an evil conscience, you'll begin to slip and you'll begin to forsake the assembling of yourselves together. You'll begin to not provoke to love and good works. You'll begin to waver in your faith, and you'll begin to not fear sin. You'll begin to not fear the Scriptures, and you'll begin to not fear the Savior. How much sore punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he is sanctified an unholy thing. What a thing. You know what? It goes on. It says this. For we know, verse 30, him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. The Lord Jesus Christ is the living God. And if you fall into his hands from an evil conscience, listen to me now, it starts subtly with a weak conscience. It starts there by getting wounded and then defiled, and before long it becomes evil conscience. It starts off, you just don't fear sin. And then you don't fear the Scriptures. And then before long you don't fear the Savior. What a thing. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. Joshua chapter number 4. Joshua chapter number 4, verse 19. And the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal in the east border of Jericho. Verse 20. And those 12 stones which they took out of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? Then shall ye let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until ye were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we were gone over. That all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, and that ye might fear the Lord your God forever. You know what? I could reminisce. Brother Josh knows a little bit. Brother Chad knows a little bit about my testimony and what God's done for me. What God's done over time, and when I've been down in a valley and how he's picked me up and what God's done for me. I could go on for hours and hours of how good God is. God is great. God is good all the time. And you know what? That's what Joshua says. He says, you know what? We're going to put these stones up there and call it Gilgal. We're going to come up and we're going to say that whenever people come in time to come, what are these stones? That we'll be able to tell them what God's done for us and how he brought us over Jordan on dry land, how he brought us out of Egypt. And I'm here to tell you, listen to your pastor, listen to your youth pastor. There's some things us older folks have been through and seen God's hand and what God's done for us. You know why God does some things for us? The goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance, that you might fear him. And God's able to do some things. When I hear about Ashley, when I hear about my Uncle Joe, when I know they're about Timmy, and I read things and I hear things and I see things, what he's done in my life. Boy, it brought the fear of God in me. Man, God is mighty, that high and lofty one that inhabits all eternity. I think there of Isaiah. Isaiah said, woe is me. Woe is me, for I'm unclean. I'm a man of unclean lips. You know what? I dwell amongst the people of unclean lips. And you know what? Isaiah realized the holiness of God and the mighty power of God and how unrighteous he is. You know, the truth of the matter is there's somebody in here this morning that hadn't realized how mighty he is, how holy God is, and how righteous he is, and how vile you truly are. Yeah, we for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Yeah, we talk about those verses. It comes kind of nonchalant to you, but you don't fear the Savior. You see, if you If you reject Jesus Christ, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. There's nothing else you can do to get saved than through Jesus Christ. And if you're sitting here this morning, you're lost, you're condemned, you're unclean, the Bible says that you're under the wrath of God. The Bible says there that you're a child of wrath, even as others. You know what the Bible says there? The Bible says that wrath will consume you into eternal devil's hell, where their worm dieth not, where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Hell is real this morning. The Bible says hell hath enlarged herself. There's coming a time when every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess to God. But if you don't bow this morning, if you don't fear your sin, if you don't fear the Scriptures, if you don't fear the Savior, and bow this morning and get saved, you're going to hell. You're going to hell. There's nothing else you can do this morning. You know what? The Lord Jesus Christ, He laid some things on my heart when he saved my soul of how filthy I was, how unrighteous I was, how ungodly I was, and I realized I needed the Savior. I teach a small Bible study about 45 minutes away to a small group of people. And I was talking to a young man, his name was DJ, and he had a lot of trouble with some drugs and alcohol and things in his life. And I began to talk with him, and he said, "Yeah, preacher." He immediately had a respect for the things of God and for that old book. And I'd pull out that old King James Bible, and he said, "I know that's God's word." I began to deal with DJ on his need for the Savior, and he said, "Well, I'm going to try to clean up my life. I'm going to get some things right." Long story short, I've been dealing with DJ for about a year, year and a half, give or take. I continued ever since. I'd see DJ every time I'd see him. I'd point him to the cross, point him to the Calvary, point him to sanctification. I saw DJ about a month ago. I preached a wedding, and I was there, and DJ's like, "Man, I got to get right." He'd come talk with me once in a while, and then he'd fall, and you'd hear he was doing bad again. Then he'd get back up and try to do right again. Then he'd fall and get back into sin again. And he came to me at the wedding, and he said, "Man, preacher," he said, "you preached hard at that wedding." He said, "Man, I never realized that a wedding was a picture of the salvation Christ wrought with the bride and everything. I never heard that before." I said, "DJ, you need to be saved. You need to be part of the bride of Christ." He said, "I know." He said, "You know, preacher," he said, "I got on Suboxone. This stuff's going to help me get off of all the bad medication, all the bad drugs I was on. This is a doctor prescribed this. A doctor's going to help me." I said, "You know what, DJ?" I said, "You need the Lord to help you." We began to talk a little bit, and he said, "All right, I'm going to be there next week." He said, "I got some things to do right now." He said, "But next week, I'm going to be there. Next week, I'm going to be there." Next week, Bible study came around. I was hoping DJ would be there. I'd been in prayer for him. And his wife came and said, "Pray for DJ. He's in the hospital. He's not doing good. Doctors don't know what's going on and everything. He's suffering and things going on. Please pray for DJ." I tried to look him up. I called him, left a message, texted him, everything else. I couldn't get a hold of him. I wanted to go see him at the hospital. I couldn't get through to him. A week came by. He got out of the hospital. He's doing better. I said, "Well, praise the Lord." I said, "You need to get in church." I was telling his wife. He said he went to stay with his mom closer to the hospital in case of complications. Turns out he had a blood infection. Turns out DJ had a blood infection. And I said, "Man, he's only like 23, 24 years old. Man, that's blood infection is not a good thing." Started talking with him a little bit more. Excuse me, his wife. I talked with her, and come to find out, they put him on some medication, some antibiotics, and they thought everything was good, so they released him from the hospital. We got home. He started throwing up real bad. He was allergic to the antibiotics. So therefore, not only was he throwing up all the medicine, but it wasn't helping his blood infection. DJ turned better, turned worse, and that was a Wednesday evening. By Sunday morning, I came out of church, and they called me. DJ passed away. To my knowledge, DJ never got saved. Never trusted the Lord Jesus. Oh, he called me, "Oh, preacher. I'm going to get right, preacher. I'm going to do this, preacher. I'm going to get better, preacher." But he did not fear the Savior.
Right.
He didn't fear sin.
Amen.
He didn't fear the Scriptures that I was giving him. And he never feared the Savior to bow that knee and trust the Lord Jesus Christ.
Right.
Pastors, you come this morning, I wonder, this morning, do you fear sin? Do you fear the Scriptures? Do you fear
the Savior.
Every head bowed, every eye closed.
Pianists come. As she comes, listen, the altar's already open. Just take her just a minute, begin playing. Brother Mike K is going to sing. Young folks, now's the time. He's going to sing, but while the piano's playing, listen, you're not going to hear a more real message on sin, on the fear of God. It's time to respond. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Why don't you come as they sing?
And the preacher preached with power. He gave the invitation as I stood to bow my head. An old man ran down the aisle. I can't forget the words he said. It better be real. Savior.
Listen, folks, young folks.
It better be.
If you're down here on the altar and you're not saved, you want a youth worker to come down with you, why don't you raise your hand?
Have you trusted in his word?
Are you born again? Do you know we're going to spend eternity?
It's not what you've
done. Anyone
all,
go ahead, raise your hand. We'll have a youth worker bring you, show you in the Bible.
It's through the blood of his son. Oh, don't hesitate. Come before it's too late. Oh, it better be real.
He's going to continue singing in just a moment. Listen, we're in no rush. Maybe you're still in your pew. Maybe God dealt with your heart. Maybe God put his finger something on your life. Why don't you respond as he gets ready to sing in a moment? Listen, sin is no joke. You better fear God. You better fear the scripture. You better fear the Savior. Every head bowed and every eye closed. As Micaiah continues to sing.
It was at an old camp meeting, I was sitting on the back row. My selfish pride and religion, it was all for show. The preacher preached right in my face. It was like he had read my mail. I fell on my face. I met amazing grace. Now I'll never see the flames of hell.
Amen.
Thank God that it's real.
Amen.
I trusted the Savior.
Yes.
I'm so glad it's real, for I trusted in his word. It's not what I've done, it took the blood of his son. I'll never forget the day. That day I got saved. Oh, I'm so glad it's real. It's not what you've done. It's through the blood of his son. Oh, don't hesitate. Come before it's too late. Oh, it better be real.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. You can look up here. I tell you, that was a wonderful message. I appreciate that, Brother Mark. And I knew he would come and preach to you the Word of God. I was thankful to see the attentive heart of many of the young folks that responded. And listen, just because you didn't come to the altar, I know that doesn't mean you didn't respond. But I hope you took heed to the message. And I surely hope you fear sin, you fear the Scripture, and you fear the Savior. And I'm not going to re-preach the message, but Brother Mark was preaching already at this church. I've preached several funerals, and I was thinking one in particular. I think the lady was 37 years old here in Lincoln Park in the funeral home, and preaching her funeral as she OD'd on heroin was her 9-year-old daughter sitting in the front row. You know what was shocking beyond that? Her 9-year-old daughter already seemed hardened to sin. I don't know if that 9-year-old girl even shed a tear. Listen, you better fear sin. That 37-year-old woman never planned as a little girl to end up as a heroin addict. She never planned to end her life. And no one does. But sin, it will destroy your life. And I'm thankful for that message. And I pray that you folks did business. And I believe you did. Now we are going to shift gears again, a little bit of a roller coaster. Have some fun and seriousness and preaching. But again, thank you all for coming out. We're going to end with a Nerf war. And I'm going to turn over to Brother DJ in just a moment. He's going to explain to you how we're going to do it. And we are going to be giving away another basket for the winning team. Again, so make sure that you guys go out there and have a good time. But we want to make sure you have fun also. Now, we've already divided up teams. And they're not going to be exact amount of people. Now, before you say it's not fair, let me just remind you what your mom and dad and all the preachers always say. Life's not fair. Can I also tell you war's not fair? They don't go like, oh, that team or that country has more people than we do. So we're not going to back. That's not how war works. And listen, we believe in competition around here. Again, Brother DJ is going to go over the details. He can explain to it how it works. But what I'm going to ask you is, he's coming on up. When he goes over the details, what I'm going to ask you is, we're going to have, we got it broke up into 4 different teams. I'm going to announce what those teams are now. I'm also going to announce who's going to play first. So those first 2 teams that I tell you who's going to play first, you guys will exit here first. Once Brother DJ gives you the instructions, you'll get your guns and goggles and then go into the arena. The other 2 teams, there's rows of 15 chairs in front of each window. You'll sit there and stage, so that way when the game ends, we can quickly get the other teams in there. Because it's going to be a double elimination Nerf tournament. And we don't want to have to try to find you. So again, I'll try to stick around. I will reiterate the instructions of how it works to the second 2 teams. But go ahead and pay attention now. But here's the teams real quick. Victory is by themselves. They have enough young folks. And so Victory will be 1 team. Lighthouse will be 1 team. And then we have Harvest, Bethel Baptist, and Willis. You all will make up 1 team. And then we will have Secord Baptist and Heritage will make up 1 team. And again, that's about 10, 11, or 12 when you break it up that way. So we just kind of try to get the numbers as close as possible. Anyone need me to repeat what team you're on? Obviously, Victory and Lighthouse is pretty simple. And then it's Secord and Heritage are together. And then Harvest, Willis, and Bethel are together. The first game is going to be between Victory versus Harvest, Bethel, and Willis. So that is the first game. With that said, Brother DJ, why don't you come up, explain to them the rules, and kind of get them going. Here, you can have this. Okay. Got a question over there?
Yes, sir.
What team do you want Prayer Baptist Church to be on?
We left out prayer.
They snuck in on you.
Okay, how many do you have?
6 guys?
I'll figure it out in a minute. Let me explain the rules.
Okay. Thank you for Elijah for bringing that to our attention. Okay, guys. What we're going to have is a ultimate Nerf war. I really feel like we could almost just go home. That was the climax of the day. I mean, I know you guys enjoy Nerf wars, but man, that was good preaching and teaching to those 2 preachers. So
just have them go home and we'll play.
You'll have the... that was some good stuff. So this will be your Nerf gun that you guys will all be using. You'll pull it back to cock it. Slide it forward, and then it will shoot. It probably might. Yep, there, shoot. The object is your team. There's going to be a safe zone and a respawn. On your opponent's safe zone, you are going to see these flags laying on the ground. There's going to be referees stationed around the perimeter and by these safe zones. You are going to attempt to run into your opponent's safe zone, grab their flag. Once you're in their safe zone, you get a free pass back to your side. You'll put your arm up, the referee will raise his arm, and you can get to walk back to the flag. We're going to have 7 flags that you're going to capture from your opponents for a capture the flag. Now, this is only going to be a 5-minute game, so it's going to be fast. And we have bracelets. Each person's going to get 2 bracelets of their color, either red or blue. Once you get shot, you go back to your side on the respawn. You're going to take off one of those bracelets, and you only have 1 life left. 1 more life to live. I hope you live it for God. 1 more life to live, okay? All right. So it's a double elimination. Now, we're going to have referees watching, okay? If the referee tells you you're hit, you may not have felt it or might not realize it, you're hit. Know why? Because they told you you're hit. Okay? And I love that saying because I tell my kids, life's not fair. They may not get it right, but they're right anyways, all right? So to try to make it smoothly. And also, kids, please, the refs will call the person out, or if you know you got hit, call yourself out. But what we don't want is I shot you over there behind bunker number 3, standing up there, you in the blue. Just don't do that. If they didn't realize they got hit and they didn't call themselves out, play on, okay? We'll let the refs if you get hit, call yourself out. If you know you got hit, call yourself out. Be honest, right? I hope we don't have any, we want to be dishonest, right? Right? We don't want to be like liars that have their part in the lake of fire. Yeah, so let's be honest, right? We're trying to have fun, have some good fellowship. So you have referees posted. Like I said, there'll be a safe zone. You're going to try to run into your opponent's safe zone. You have 5 minutes. You also have a respawn. After you get hit, you walk back to your respawn. There'll be a bucket or something there. Just take off your bracelet, set your bracelet down, and immediately enter back into the game. Okay. All right. Is there a...
Yeah, let me take Michael just a second.
Okay. All right. So we're going to have to split prayer, and that's fine. So what we're going to do, let me see actually... Again, I just said life's not fair, right? So maybe I'll just throw. Is there 6 of you all? 6. All right. So let's see. Let me double check. Hold that right there. No, hold on. Well, we got this. Heritage. Here's Heritage. And Willis. And what's the other one? That's not the right one. Bethel. How many does Bethel have here? 3. Right. Hold on 1 second. Sorry about that. No, it's Harvest Bethel. Harvest, because Heritage is down there. Harvest, Bethel, and Willis. What's that total there? That's 13. Okay, so you guys have 13. Lighthouse has 12. Victory has 11. All right, we are going to throw all 6 of you with Heritage, Secord, and Prayer. They're the largest team. So you have joined Secord Baptist and Heritage. All right, Prayer?
So are they part of the...
Yep. They're at this one. We're adding them there. Okay. All right, so what I need, Prayer is going again. Secord Baptist and Heritage, you're going with Prayer. We've added you on there. You guys got the largest team, but that's all right. All right, so what we need is Victory and Harvest, Bethel, and Willis to go into the gym area.
In the hallway.
In the hallway. What's that, brother?
Some people want to change.
Yeah, you guys can change. We can give you about 5 minutes. You want to go change? Go ahead and change. We'll give you 5 minutes, so you want them in the...
Am I staying here for just the time being?
They're charging. Why don't you put them in the gym area?
Who's that?
The first teams.
Okay.
And that way we can have them room. All right, so go on out there. Brother DJ will come out there in a minute and get the first group going. That's okay. Don't worry about it.
A little bit on the fly.
Well, because I've got my stuff.
So once I get them, I'll start getting them. So does that... All right. So I'll just say Victory will be blue just to keep it...
That's fine. So you got Victory, and then this is H&H. This is Harvest, Bethel, and Willis.
Okay.
I'm going to write it. What's that, bud? I'm not sure. We'll find out for you, though.